Well, thank you very much. Just to recap, I'm Jack Sprague, president of the college, and I wanted to introduce Representative Paul Heroux, Representative Betty Poirier, and a representative from Congressman Kennedy's office, Lisa Nelson. So thank you very much for coming. We have community people here, and a number of people, not just at BCC, and that's what we're all about, community. I often say community is our middle name, and it's because of events like this that we make ourselves available to the community. So I'm so glad that we have such a good crowd here. We want to move ahead quickly, and I'm going to introduce Judy Bolands, who will then introduce our speakers. So thank you again for coming, and it's going to be a wonderful afternoon. Thank you. Judy Boland.
We're very pleased today to have with us two professors who are sharing their knowledge with us. They've done extensive work, and so the brief bios that I'm giving doesn't even begin to discuss all of the work that they've done, but they'll tell you a lot about that. So today we have with us Madeline Otis Campbell, Dr. Campbell. She's an assistant professor of urban studies at Worcester State, where she directs the Center for the Study of Human Rights and sits on the Women's Studies and Global Studies faculty. She's a cultural anthropologist who specializes in refugee migration in urban contexts across the Middle East and North America. Prior to her work at Worcester State, she worked as a refugee officer in the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Egypt, and Jordan. We also have Dr. Dana Johnbeck. She's an associate professor of public relations at LaSalle College in Newton. Her research focuses on the use of communication technologies by Syrian refugees living in refugee camps and urban areas in Jordan. Dr. Janbeck has also done research on terrorist use of the internet as a communication tool. She often serves as a commentator on issues related to her research areas in the Boston media. And prior to entering academia, she worked for the Embassy of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan in Washington, D.C. She's originally from Jordan and fluent in Arabic. Welcome to both of you. We're really excited to hear you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for the very warm welcome. We had lunch with a number of faculty, staff, and the representatives earlier, and we're very, very thankful for this warm welcome to your community. And thank you most of all for the organizers, for Joe and Judy, and everyone who worked with you to make this happen. We're absolutely honored to be here. So today, as you know, we are going to talk to you about the Syrian refugee crisis. From our perspective and from all the interviews we have done with Syrian refugees over the last few years. So we'll start from the very beginning. As you know, the Syrian refugee crisis is the latest of the many events that have taken place in the Arab world over the last really 6 years. Since December of 2010, we have started seeing mass-scale protests in different parts of the Arab world, starting with Tunisia. A lot of these protests in the Arab world consists of 23 countries. A lot of these protests did not lead to anything more than simply a large-scale protest. But in some cases, such as in Libya, in Egypt, and in Syria, it has led, obviously, to much, much more. In Syria specifically, the situation, the war has been going on since March 2011, and the situation has escalated in terms of the death of the Syrians and in terms of the number of people who have become refugees. So this is a map of the region where we have spent a little bit of time. As you can see, the numbers represent the number of Syrian refugees who have ended up in the Arab world. So since the start of the war in Syria in March 2011, there have been approximately half of Syria's population has been displaced. So again, that's half of the country's population has been displaced. The majority of those displaced have been displaced internally, where they basically have moved from one city to another. And I say that in extremely simple terms. In reality, many of the families we've met have actually moved anywhere from 40, 50. Some families have reported moving 60 times, within Syria before they made the difficult decision of moving outside of Syria. So half of the population has displaced, the majority has been displaced internally, and then over 4.8 million have been displaced externally. And this is a representation of the external displacement. So in the region, you can see that Turkey currently is host to 2.7 million refugees. So Turkey is the single country that's hosting the largest number of refugees. After that, you have Lebanon, which is host to 1 million refugees. And then you have Jordan, which is host to over 600,000. Now, and of course, the situation in Syria is so bad that people are going to Iraq and Egypt to seek refuge, which are the two other countries that have absorbed refugees. These are, of course, all the official numbers. The unofficial numbers put the number of refugees at even higher than the numbers I'm sharing with you. So in Jordan, it's estimated that there are actually, in reality, over 1 million refugees. And I'll try to put that number in context. So what's happened in Jordan in terms of the increase in the population is equivalent to all of Canada moving into the United States. So in a hypothetical situation, if all of Canada was to move to the US tomorrow, the US population will increase by about 10%. And that's exactly what happened in Jordan since the start of the war. The population has increased by 10%. So I'll just leave that number with you to kind of think about what does that mean in terms of the pressure that this added population has on resources, the people seeking employment, what does it mean in terms of simple things such as accessing water. Jordan happens to be one of the poorest countries in terms of water in the world, water access in the world. So you can imagine what are the short-term pressures that this puts on a country, what are the long-term pressures that this puts on countries. To compare this to what we have been seeing in media reports about the refugee crisis in Europe, the refugee crisis in Europe basically is the result of approximately 1 million refugees, many of whom are Syrian, but not all, trying to reach the shores of Europe. So the EU, a union of over 20 countries, is trying to absorb approximately 1 million refugees. And now compare that to one country, which is Jordan, trying to absorb the same number of people. And compare that to Turkey, trying to absorb 2.7 million people. So hopefully these numbers try to put in perspective the use of the term crisis. We have referenced what's happening in Europe as a refugee crisis. Well, in fact, the region has been witnessing this crisis for a number of years already. So this is Jordan. We've spent, Professor Campbell and I spent the last 2.5 years visiting with Syrian refugees who live in different parts of Jordan. And we'll talk to you today specifically about the conditions that the refugees live under, what their situation is like, how they manage financially, their hopes and dreams, and what they have basically shared with us. To help you think about what our journey has been like. So we've been going back and forth for the last couple of years, and we have been meeting with Syrian refugee families, A, to understand their situation, and B, to understand the general refugee crisis, and most specifically, C, to answer specific research questions we have about the use of technology. The use of technology to navigate their situation in this new country that they're in. And specifically, without realizing, we ended up specifically studying how cell phones have been used to help refugees navigate their new settings and help them connect with resources that are available to them in their new communities. So we'll talk to you about all of that. This is most of the pictures we're sharing with you today are from our trips. With a couple of exceptions, and you'll be able to pick up which couple of exceptions these are. And the other thing we'll talk to you about are stereotypes that we have of refugees. And, you know, stereotypes, what are the realities, what are the myths? We often, when we think of refugees, we think of tents. That's usually the image that comes to mind. But in reality, in Jordan, the majority of refugees actually live in urban areas. So in Jordan, there are about 5 refugee camps. And within these refugee camps, you have approximately 100,000 refugees. But the majority, so if you remember, the initial number is 600,000, the majority of refugees actually live in Amman, in the capital, and in the outskirts of the capital. So we have been visiting refugees both in refugee camps and in the outskirts of the capital. And we'll talk to you about these 3 different types of spaces that they occupy in their new country. So again, the first is the refugee camps, the biggest of which being Zaatari camp. That's Z-A-A-T-A-R-I, Zaatari camp. And that's the one that has received the most media attention. At its height, it had over 100,000 refugees living only in one single camp. And so that's the first space, the refugee camps. The second space is urban areas, so people living in apartments, like all of us probably do in this room. And the third space are people who have taken their tents from UNHCR and moved to a field where they set up the tent and made agreements with the owner of the land that they will be living on, usually on his land. So those are the 3 spaces that we will talk to you in more detail. And I'll hand it over to my colleague. This is a picture from one of the biggest camp, Zaatari camp, which is where we will start our conversation.
I talk with my hands, so if I don't have my hands, I can't talk. I want to, with this image in mind, actually scan out for a global picture, and then we're going to go back to Jordan and talk about those 3 environments in which refugees live. I want to scan out to say that this refugee crisis is unparalleled in modern history, not only for its scale and magnitude, but for its timing. It came right after a major financial crisis. Okay, so I often tell people that these refugees leaving Syria are not just fleeing a civil war, they're also refugees of a financial crisis. And what I mean by that is that the response, the global response to this refugee crisis has been hampered by the constitutive governments' budgets in the international community being constrained after the financial crisis. That's to say that everyone's budgets have been strained, benefits to citizens of governments around the world have been cut, let alone their ability to give money to the United Nations or other international organizations to help people beyond their borders. So in fact, today, it's been said that only 45% of the total amount of money that would be needed to deal with this crisis in terms of housing, access to healthcare, in terms of access to education, just to name a few things, has actually been delivered to Syrian refugees. 45%. That means that more than half of the existing need is unmet. There recently, in recognition of this fact, and as an aside, this is also one of the reasons that there was this massive crisis and massive movement towards Europe. Okay, so it came to such a boiling point, this lack of funds for basic UN infrastructure like the World Food Program that delivers food aid to people that are outside of their country because of a civil war. The World Food Program closed in Jordan, cut its services. So last summer, this got to such a critical point that people made this very risky decision to go to Europe in large numbers. Did you guys hear about this? So the reason for that is something that people call donor fatigue. Donor fatigue. So even that little bit of money that countries were scraping up or whatever to give to the United Nations and other international organizations was declining and declining and declining. And One effect of the massive influx of refugees to Europe has been that now the European nations have come together to try to collectively get more resources to refugees in the Middle East, in effect, to keep them in the Middle East. Okay, so this has had the effect of, they raised $10 billion in February. $10 billion to help Syrian refugees within Syria and in the contiguous states surrounding it. But I want us just to keep in mind this global economic perspective. In response to that global economic perspective, the situation that individual refugee families face really differs depending on which of three contexts they find themselves living in. So I'm going to talk about those three contexts again, which are the camps, our urban settings, cities, and informal camps in or around cities. And I'm going to focus in each of those on the political economic conditions, and that's to say financial resources, principally refugees' ability to find work. That's going to be the focus that I look at it in these three contexts. So Dr. Jean Beck mentioned stereotypes. We have this image, I think, of refugees as living in camps. And for good reasons, many refugees do live in camps. This is Zaatari Refugee Camp, whose most famous visitor was Angelina Jolie. Just this week, Bono went. And it is because, I think, there is a sense that, you know, you can understand, you can wrap your head around the refugee experience if it's encapsulated in a camp with tents and you can kind of understand it. But in fact, the scale of refugee crises are much bigger than camps, right? And so 85% of the folks in Jordan, the Syrian people who have left because they have no hope to stay in their homes, they've sold their farms or their house and they've left for Syria, live in the city. 85%, and only 15% live in contexts like the Zaatari camp. But it's contexts like this that get the big high-profile visitors, right? Because it's a better photo op, you know, standing behind a big sea of tents is an easier, you can tell a story better than just, you know, the individuals you meet that are navigating the city. You can't gather them together and tell the story on the same scale. So Zaatari refugee camp, just to tell you a little bit about it. Zaatari refugee camp is now the fourth largest city in Jordan. So it began, and I believe it still has the claim to fame of being the second largest refugee camp in the world. It began as a relatively improvised settlement. The UN always says that it created the camp and the Syrians created the city. And the Syrian refugees really did take ownership of this space and made it a city. All of the streets that you say, I guess you don't see streets on this map, but this shows 12 districts. And the way that people set up their tents or later caravans was really close to family. So you see kind of organic clustering of people and then organic formations of roads. And eventually, you see a massive street develop, which is called the Champs-Élysées, right? And this is a play also on the term Champs, which refers to Syria, the Champs-Élysées. The Champs-Élysées, of course, is a famous commercial street in Paris, and the Champs-Élysées in Zaatari is a massive, massive market, okay, where you can feel like you're in many parts of the world. We don't have, it's hard to take pictures on the Champs-Élysées because there is so much going on. You know, you have boys wheelbarrowing goods over here and older women looking at produce over here and younger women looking at wedding dresses and young men playing video games in an internet cafe. It's very hard to get that all in. But I hope I can paint a picture. The picture I want to paint is of an entirely illegal economic situation, okay? So this is informal economy, petty commerce, that the Jordanian government, to their credit, has decided to turn a blind eye to, okay? In recognition of the fact that Jordanians, to survive now, do not have enough aid from the UN alone. They do not have enough aid from NGOs or charities alone. They have to work, And to work, people are making jobs for themselves in the market. So Jordan has been actually really on the forefront of allowing refugees to work. This is a really hard sell, and it's a very challenging situation because their unemployment rate in Jordan is very high for Jordanians. So add to that a population that is not there, that is not, you know, a citizen of the country, and there is a lot of, you know, there are mixed responses to this. But what Jordan has done has been to say, look, we recognize that in order to survive and to not be a drain on our resources, it actually is in everyone's best interest that refugees work. And so they've given 28-day rights to work that are renewable and have also begun rolling out a more ambitious employment plan, the details of which are still kind of becoming clear. But this is really different from other places. In Lebanon, if you work, and to some extent in Jordan, if you're working in the wrong sector or something, or get caught by the wrong policeman, you'll go to prison, right? But on a national scale, there is a priority to give these licenses as possible to refugees. Now, not everyone can get them. For a long time, though, they were very expensive. There's now, again, a move to make them more accessible in a more broader scale. But the importance of this is that refugees cannot afford not to work. So refugees bring to the Champs-Élysées produce, pets, their pet stores, computers for computer labs. And here are those ubiquitous wheelbarrows that I mentioned. This is also one of the modes of public transportation in the camp. It's a vast, vast camp. And if you have mobility impairments, this is an option of getting to the doctor. Okay. I want to talk now about where refugees live in larger numbers, which is in informal settlements and in the city. First, the informal settlements. Because work is so important, many refugees find a safe haven, a place to live, on the land of an agricultural producer that will allow them to stay there in exchange for work. Okay, and they'll be paid a small amount as well. But that's a pattern that's widespread throughout Jordan, where refugee families live on a farm and work in exchange, receiving some protection and some pay. Whether it's fruit, Jordan, much of the country, not all of the country, has a robust agricultural sector. And so, you know, there are orchards and all sorts of different crops. This is inside one of the one such settlement where you can see the family has a washing machine there, and this is the kitchen where they would feed the larger family group. So some families set up informal settlements on farms. The urban kind of corollary to this would be to set up on a agricultural packaging plant. So there are packaging plants where produce is packaged for sale, where you will also find a lot of informal settlements. Refugees that live there in exchange in that context for running water, electricity, maybe some, you know, protection, and work for some pay. There's my colleague, Dr. Jambek. The third context is the urban context. Now, this is by far the least studied and the most challenging place for refugees to live. Refugees have to confront potentially predatory landlords who, because refugees have very little legal rights in Jordan, have no recourse if the landlord raises the rent overnight. They have a hard time accessing services. So there's in the camp, for all of the hardships of living in a camp, some people have called it like an outdoor prison, at least all the services are concentrated in one place. In the city, services are dispersed. And you have to work hard to find them. You know, you don't get a little booklet crossing the border from Syria into Jordan saying, like, you know, this NGO will give you healthcare, this NGO will give you education. You have to find it out yourself. And our research has shown that the cell phone is the mechanism by which refugees do that. And the importance of the cell phone is finding those services and, above all, finding work. So the urban area is also important and challenging to think about because, well, the market, the informal market in Za'atari, the Jordanian government has turned a blind eye to it, saying, you know, this is an important way for refugees to earn a living so that they can not be a drain on our state resources. In the city, there are far more young children and other people who haven't received the necessary permit to work, who work illegally and do so to survive, but also with at great risk and feel great, you know, fear leaving in the morning to work. So here are some of the families that we met who's in urban areas whose constant sort of complaints about their life were rent, right? Rent and healthcare, education, sending their kids to school. And there's an information gap also about where those services are available. As I was mentioning, you know, can my children go to public school? Now, increasingly, children can go to public school in Jordan, but there's not widespread information. And so you need, you as an individual bear the brunt of the responsibility of finding out that information. And how do you do it? You do it with your cell phone. So as the crisis has deteriorated, intensified, more and more of the families we talk to are talking about resettlement to a third country. So when we started doing this research 3 years ago, people were still hopeful that they could earn enough of their money, earn enough money to make a living to someday return to Jordan, to Syria, excuse me. That hope has all but vanished, even with the very precarious peace deal that's in place now. So this is a young boy whose family had applied for resettlement to the United States and has been waiting for 6 months to hear about the status of their application. They bought a special phone that they thought would, with a carrier who they thought had the best service, so that they would never miss a call. And they don't go to the bathroom without carrying this phone. They call it their America phone, and they just wait for that phone to ring. Okay, they're not unique. Some people still do wish to stay in the region. It is not everyone's wish to come to the United States or Canada. But for these families that really do not envision a future for their children in Syria, resettlement's a really important option. Canada began a really audacious resettlement plan to bring tens of thousands of refugees in a short time frame to Canada over the winter, which they have. And the US has now, since February, initiated a surge in processing of Syrian refugees in the Middle East to also help meet the need of families like this. And we haven't followed up with this particular family. I don't know if their America phone rang. But I will now pass it back over to Donna Jeanbeck to give some concluding remarks. And then we want to leave a lot of time for your questions and some discussion.
So I'll pick up where Professor Campbell left. And again, thinking about stereotypes of the stereotypes we have in our minds of Syrian refugees. And I do want to emphasize the last point, which is it is absolutely not everyone's wish to come to the US or to come to Canada. And the reasons are relatively obvious. Many people do not speak English as a second language. They're this notion of going to a foreign land that they are not familiar with its culture and customs is not does not sound desirable at all. And they do. Their one and only dream is to go back to Syria. And I would say that pretty much every family we've ever met, our meeting always ends with Inshallah, by God's will, we will go back to Syria. And that's their absolute dream. Nevertheless, the reality has been very different and very far from what people dream to do, which is go back, you know, what, nothing is like home, to go back to their home. And the reality is the war has been ongoing for over 5 years, and we're already in the sixth year of the war. By some estimates, over 200,000 Syrians have been killed. By other estimates, as many as 470,000 have been killed. And we talked earlier about half of the population being displaced. So the reality is, during this time, during the last 5 years, many of the refugees have, those who are professionals, and many of them are, such as nurses, engineers, we've met educators, they have been becoming de-skilled over the years. And let's think about that for a minute. If you were to be removed from your job, and you're sitting at home or in a tent, and you're sitting there for 5 years, of course, over time, you're going to start losing some of your knowledge of your field. And that's what's happening to a whole segment of the population. Because many of those who are working, they are not working in their fields, of course. They're doing odd jobs. We've met the father of this young boy, his job is to recycle light bulbs. So he has figured out a way to make broken light bulbs work again. So he collects light bulbs that are discarded in shops nearby his home, and he fixes them and sells them back. Who knew this was possible? But it is. And that's the job that he has created for himself. He has created this job for himself because his number one priority, like everyone in this room, is his family. And because his family is his number one priority, he has figured out how to make a little bit of income for himself. And it's families like him, even though, again, not everyone wants to come, there are people who do. And it's families like him, especially ones with young children, who truly do not see a future in their current situation. Of course, how could you see a future in your current situation? And it's those families who are thinking that our best option is to flip our life upside down and go to a country we've barely heard of, and try to figure it out there. It was always a kind of a little bit of a game when we would tell the families we met that we're from Massachusetts. Oh, where is Massachusetts? No, I want to go to California. And we would go back, back and forth talking about the different states. We didn't mention earlier, but one of our good colleagues, Melissa Wall from California State University, is the third researcher who has gone with us on those trips. And often she would, she's from California, so of course when the families we meet find out she's from California, they all agree that they'll be going back home with her instead of Maddie and I. Nothing against the Northeast. So going back to this notion, all the families we met, they're very resilient, and really their hopes, like the hopes of all of us in this room, is to have a safe and a better life for their future. I will mention one more thing though. This, in addition to the parents becoming de-skilled, you also have the children not going to school. So approximately across the region, 50% of the children are not going to school, and they haven't been in school for 5 years. So let's think about that for a minute. What is it gonna look like when you have a whole country where you have this much of your population not going to school? Who's gonna be rebuilding the country with money that obviously no one has yet? But once we get to that stage and the war ends eventually, how is this country gonna be rebuilt when the parents are getting de-skilled and the children are not going to school? So there are different levels of problems related to the refugee crisis. And I will end by thanking, these are a number of the children that we met, again, many of whom are not going to school. I'll end by thanking a number of people who have helped us with this research, starting with, again, our colleague, Melissa Wall, His Royal Highness Prince Ali's office, who facilitated our research in the country, and Marissa Horma, who also helped us a great deal navigating the scenario in Jordan. And then There are a number of individuals at UNHCR and a number of churches who have helped connect us with refugee families. And last but not least, Macy for holding this event and inviting us to speak, and our individual universities who have sponsored our research, and the Whiting Foundation for also have sponsored our research. This is our contact information. If you are, we're going to take questions and answers, but if you're interested in connecting with us, you're interested in having us speak to your different organizations that you belong to, please do not hesitate to reach out. As you can probably tell, we're very passionate about this topic and are very eager to educate and start a conversation about the crisis. So thank you, everyone.
And in that vein, we wanted to leave a lot of time for questions because we've done this talk at lots of different places and find that the question and answer is always the most valuable for you and for us. So if you have any question, however remote or whatever, we want to hear it and we're happy to answer it.
You said that the refugees are going to Canada and now some are coming to the United States. What is the average, let's say for instance, the ones like that family, what's the average wait time for them for the United States to react to a process their paperwork and get them here in the United States?
That's a great question.
The question
was, what is the processing time for an average family going to Canada or the United States? I can't answer exactly, but I can answer with some previous experience in my work working with Iraqi refugees and from observation of the Canadian system. So the Canadian initiative that we observed was very ambitious. They wanted to process refugees inside of 2 days. That means everything from initial interviews with the United Nations to referrals to, you know, background tests, fingerprints, to run through all of the the global security systems, and biomedical background, all of these things, and then matching them with the right city in Canada that has the right services for them and their children. They do that within 2 days. It has, in some cases, it's taken 2 weeks. But then the idea that some people are calling this effort an airlift because it's so ambitious. It's you know, effectively, you know, you apply and then you get taken on a chartered flight to Canada within a couple of weeks. By comparison, the US system is much slower. When I used to interview refugees as a refugee officer in the Middle East, people had been waiting for my interview for a year and a half, 2 years often, just to sit in front of the US official who will decide whether or not they're going to be able to go to the United States. And then after that, they wait often another month, several months, maybe 6 months, for cultural orientation and to be placed with the right organization that's going to receive them on the US side. So it varies a lot. Given the current and the heightened and intent, you know, greater interest in processing Syrian refugees, it might be a little bit faster than that, but I just don't know exactly how fast it is.
That money that was raised, why can't some refugees have it?
Great question. So it is beginning now to be dispersed. I don't know exactly. I've tried to do some research to figure out how it's actually going to refugees, and so far that sort of level of transparency isn't abundantly clear to me as a researcher, but you would presumably it should be getting to refugees and soon, right? The priority is to people within Syria itself to help with healthcare, education, and other basic services to those that have been displaced within Syria itself, and then secondarily to refugees around the country of Syria.
So I'll add quickly, there are over, in Jordan alone, the official number is something like 50 organizations working with refugees. The unofficial number is something like 150 organizations working with refugees. So there are many, many, many units who are trying to help refugees. But again, we go back to this notion of donor fatigue. So even though Okay, so you had this conference and you raised a bit of money, which is great. That still doesn't solve the problem of the situation of refugees. It simply elongates the relief a little bit. So I think we really have to take a step back and think about what the long-term situation for these refugees, what their long-term situation will look like.
Yes, initially you said that Jordan has an unemployment problem. How does the unemployed Jordanians handle their government allowing refugees time to work? Yeah. What is the social climate?
I'll let the Jordanian answer that question.
So the answer, as with many of these issues, is complicated. A lot of Jordanians are married to Syrians or have some way connected to Syrians through marriage. My own family is an example of that. My brother-in-law, his family, one side of his family is originally Syrian. So initially, when the Syrian refugee crisis started in March 2011, the Jordanians were welcoming to Syrians because, again, those are their family members. But of course, as the crisis continued to happen and continued to unfold and the numbers continued to increase, then it has put a real stressor on the system. So you could see a shift in perception of how Jordanians feel about Syrians. And that's not unique. You can see the same case happening in different, different parts of the world. For every good story you hear of, different citizens coming out to welcome refugees, as those numbers increase, the same sentiment does not stay. So I think from the Jordanian government, a lot of what we heard, which makes sense, any new program that they try to create for refugees, they have to create something parallel to Jordan's poor. And that's perhaps a good, healthy way to approach the problem, that you're trying to address both problems. That obviously means less resources for refugees, but at least you are addressing the conflict. You see some of the conflict in schools with children, because what happened in the school system, approximately 50% are going to school, and those are going to school usually on double shifts, where the Jordanians go in the morning, the Syrian go in the afternoon, and you see some of the conflict between the kids.
I would also add, from the Jordanian government perspective, there's been a shift there too to try to look at the refugee crisis not only as a crisis but also as an opportunity for infrastructure development that affects not only the refugees but citizens, right, Jordanians. So that has to do with, in the camps, sewage and water and electricity, and in improving those grids. The camps are located, you might guess, in the less populated parts of the country and the less wealthy parts of the country. So improving those grids for all people, but as built out of necessity when you have an influx of 100,000 people in a camp. And in urban areas too, improving services for all people. This though is always a matter of political will and funding, right? So a lot of the Jordanian government support comes from the United States and other allies. And their ability to serve refugees and their own citizens is somewhat beholden and incumbent, dependent on their allies' support.
Yeah, so, sure, so I... Right, so the question is about the healthcare situation of the refugee population. Within the camps themselves, there are hospitals, and those hospitals refugees have access to. Now, obviously, you can imagine the situation. You have tens of thousands trying to access a couple of hospitals. There are long waits. So I think there are efforts to try and address them, but as with all these different areas, employment, education, and healthcare, the efforts are falling short simply because of, again, going back to resources. But there are certainly efforts to try and address them. And for those who live in urban areas, and the situation has changed over the years, but they do have, some of them have access to hospitals in urban areas as well.
I would say that in terms of epidemics, the thing that we have noticed the biggest change in is mental health. And the self-reported mental illness has increased astronomically in the last 3 years. I mean, the number of women, men, and children that have been telling us that, you know, I have lost hope is really intense and staggering. And those sort of, there are various barriers to getting mental health services, including, you know, the financial resources, but also some cultural barriers and a number of other barriers. So I would say anecdotally that one of the biggest health unmet health needs is mental health for children as well. I mean, you can imagine the amount of trauma that young children have gone through seeing their homes or neighborhoods destroyed.
I don't know if that's kind of a negative thing, but not to increase more
right.
people and bring helpless infants into this situation.
Mm-hmm. So we know of some campaigns to address different parts of the different areas that would fall under healthcare. For example, if you live in the refugee camps, one of the things you will encounter are rats. So there is literature on how to report a rat if you see one, how to the poison to use, what not to use, and so forth. So there is some literature that addresses some of the challenges that do happen. In terms of birth control, it's not an area we have studied specifically, but anecdotally we can tell you that women are having children. So they are, correct. And there are a number of women who have been, many babies who have been born in the camp itself. We've met with pregnant women, we've met with, you know, children who are less than a year old. So you have also, again, a generation of children that's being born in Jordan and who are originally Syrian, so they're not going to get the Jordanian citizenship, but they have never seen Syria.
They won't get the Jordanian citizenship? That's just how the rules work?
Right, because they're refugees over there. So on a side note, a number of the children we met, their names are Rani and Abdullah, after the names of the king and queen of Jordan. That doesn't help, you know, that's obviously, I know where you're getting at with your question. We haven't studied it, we haven't studied this area in specific, so I can't tell you that there aren't efforts, but from what we have seen, we know that families are having children.
I'll just add a little small note. Your question inspires me to talk a little bit about the disconnect between an organization's maybe goals and the actual needs on the ground. So there, for example, we heard people in the camp, Zatri again, I'm talking about that camp specifically, complain about this organization called Gynecologists Without Borders, which is a kind of similar to Doctors Without Borders, right? Gynecological health is obviously very important, but they felt that this particular organization was bringing an agenda that wasn't fair, wasn't listening to them. And so sometimes we feel we observe this disconnect between what the organization's very well-intentioned, perhaps, don't exactly respond to the needs on the ground. And so from the perspective of the refugee families, yes, it might be terrible to bring another child into such a economically impoverished and emotionally intense experience, but for a lot of people, they come from a family of large, they come from a family with lots of children, and that's the way that they've done it for a while. And to some degree also, children are an economic asset, quite different to the United States, but in this context, in the hopes of someday returning to Syria, or even with staying in Jordan or going to a third country, there's more of a sense that this is your security blanket for the future. Your children are going to take care of you. And they are, for better or for worse, children are some of the biggest earners in the camps, right? There are a lot of people who are already serving that role for their family, for better or for worse.
We have a question for the gentleman over there in the red shirt. You still have a question? Yeah, see?
I have one.
Okay, you do?
Yep.
And then after him, we have this gentleman right here.
Okay.
With Al Jazeera America being shut down,
what is, in your opinion, the best news source for developments in the Middle East?
Great question. So we follow Melissa Fleming on Facebook. Melissa Fleming is a spokesperson for UNHCR, and she has all kinds of great stories about what's really happening on the ground. So Melissa Fleming, the name spells exactly as it sounds. I would say that. I know that AJ Plus online also has many stories about refugees. So AJ Plus is another source.
And more broadly, just for Middle East geopolitical coverage, that sort of thing, you know, the BBC, The Guardian, those sort of outlets tend to have more coverage of this than American outlets.
Good question. If we're spreading all these people out throughout the whole entire world, how do you guys go about, like, identifying them and knowing that none of them are actually, like, ISIS or terrorists or anything like that?
Mm-hmm. We're like, So we identify them through all our contacts. So when we started this research a few years ago, our biggest fear was, of course, how do we even find refugees? We know where they are, but of course, for very, very good reasons, the government is and UNHCR specifically, is very protective of refugees, and they don't want people to just come and go under what has become called refugee tourism, to go and take pictures, basically, and leave. So we've worked with a lot of people on the ground, UNHCR specifically, and also different churches, who know those families and have known those families for years. So it's through those contacts, as with any research in a new setting, you really have to work with the local people to help you meet other local people. I can tell you that from our perspective, we've never had a fear that this person we're interviewing might be of an ISIS affiliate. The chances of that happening are so minute that it's not something we honestly think about.
Okay, so you're not talking about just us, you're talking about more broadly.
No, there's 200,000 of them.
Okay, so you're talking about the masses of people who go all over, above and beyond who we are interacting with. Yeah, okay, so I would just say a couple of things. The first thing to keep in mind is that attention to ISIS, which is important, can't come at the expense of the bigger picture. And the bigger picture is that the refugees are fleeing a civil war which involves ISIS. So many are fleeing those same forces, right? So they're afraid of the same bad guy, to put it on a very basic level. The other thing I would say, just in terms of the Syrians that are coming to the United States, I'll put on my former government hat. The amount of screening that we do for each individual is why the process takes 2 years. it is very exhaustive, very intensive, and it involves, I mean, in my opinion, sometimes re-traumatizing people about very minuscule details about their life to make sure that they have a credible story. So from my perspective as a former government official who was the person who stamped approve, again, this is a different caseload, this was pre-ISIS, right? But I would have a significant confidence in those systems, which can't prevent any incident, of course. And I think those programs need to exist and need to be supported more.
The lady in the back, yes.
I was wondering if you could comment on the average individual and if there's something beyond awareness that can be done. I was particularly interested in the UNHCR and what you felt their response was, because I've been to a number of other countries, so I'm aware of corruption that exists when money goes in. Mm-hmm. And for those who wish to maybe support monetarily, you don't want to obviously just blindly give to any organization. Could you speak to that part of what can be done by us?
Mm-hmm. We get this question a lot. It is an important one. So our instinct might be to send money over there, as you're kind of getting to. In fact, one of the best ways that I think you can help is by helping people who are here. Because those that have come to the United States face a really hard situation and the same economic need to be employed, right? Because the US assistance, while generous, isn't enough. And it's very short, it's a matter of months. After that point, refugees are on their own and they have to they have to learn English, find a job, and get on their own two feet. And so I would say the refugee crisis doesn't end when you get to the United States. It can be a glorious day for your family, but there's still great need. So I would suggest connecting with the local agencies that help refugees in Massachusetts and Rhode Island, of which there are many, and potentially tutoring the children or sponsoring, not sponsoring economically, but becoming the sort of like advocate or ally for the family so they can call you with a question of like, this is going on with my kid, should I go to the emergency room? Because all those things are new. You know, all of these systems and infrastructures are totally new. So that's one way. The other way, and I'm saying this for all of our university leaders and college leaders, is to offer more educational opportunities for Syrian refugees in the United States, because their credentials don't always translate. Meaning their degrees don't always put them where they belong educationally here. And so they have to start all over again, and it's hard to do that. And especially hard if you don't qualify yet for financial aid, and if you're facing this uphill battle of trying to learn the language, let alone the institutional process of becoming a student. I mean, how many of you found that hard as a local? It was for me. So offering more scholarships and pathways into higher education for refugees is something that I would strongly suggest that we think about as institutions of higher education.
Lisa.
Yeah, I was just going to say, well, two things. One is there are some Syrian folks who are here on temporary protected status because they can't go home. They found themselves in the United States, and when it came time for them to leave, they couldn't go because there was no place to go home to. So we offer something called temporary protected status. That sounds great. All it really gives you is an employment authorization card that allows you to work legally. But you can't get scholarships. You really have no status in the United States, and you're basically in limbo, and there's no promise that you'll be able to stay. So I think that's one thing we need to kind of take a look at. That would be something I would recommend. But my question to you is, I always think working for the congressman that I wish I had a money tree in the backyard and a magic wand that really worked. So if you had those two tools, how would you address the refugee crisis that exists now in Georgia?
We were hoping for an easy question, Lisa. I think we would go back to the notion of employment, because with employment comes hope, with employment comes a future, with employment comes a sense of identity. Many of us drive our sense of identity through our work, so we think of ourselves as professors, and that's part of how we see ourselves. And if you don't have that, I think it's very, very easy to fall into a very very dark, difficult place. So I would say the first thing is providing employment opportunities, and going back to the gentleman's question, to both the host country's citizens and to the refugees themselves. So that's one thing, trying to address and alleviate some of the burden that's in the Middle East. But of course, for the refugees here, I go back to Professor Campbell's point of figuring out a way to help with integration, because as refugees integrate into society and truly become part of society, we're all going to be better off. If people feel that they're home and they don't feel that they are this other group that we talk about behind their backs, we're all going to be better off. So I would say the second aspect is really figuring out resources to help refugees integrate.
And since you gave me a magic wand, I'll address the root causes of the conflict. The elimination of small arms, right? The elimination of an air campaign by Russia that we witnessed, right? On the border, the camp of Zaatari is very close to the border. And so at one point we drove to talk to some farmers who had seen people fleeing over the border into their farm and saw and heard a Russian bomb go off in front of us. This war is going on because of international continued support for the actors on the ground. And so I would say that we need to look at those causes that continue to arm and support these groups. Well, a lot of people do talk about a lost generation of Syrians because they have this absence of schooling. And not only that, they have so much, but among the many things that they suffer from is sort of absent role models, parents that are going through a lot, just so that support system that you that a child might need isn't there. So there are a lot of organizations dedicated specifically to work with children. Some are doing really great work, and I would point to others maybe having somewhat of a mismatch again between what the organization aims to do and what's actually needed on the ground. And you know, I would say that it's hard to have a comprehensive educational response to this crisis because the amount of kids that would need schooling overflows the capacity of any of these countries to actually accommodate, right? So there needs to be and is a patchwork response in terms of putting together enough schooling, double shifts of these schools. But above and beyond that, letting children tell their stories, you know, as a form of relief. Letting children find different outlets and new ways to identify, new things about their life that they are discovering. So the last time we went to Zaatari in December, we went to a fabulous, it was the happiest place in Zaatari. We kept telling the directors of the center. It was a youth center. And it had all sorts of outlets for children and youth to play and discover, a library and internet cafe and, you know, a playground, a soccer field where we saw a group of girls playing each other at a very high level. And pool tables and, you know, I mean, you just wouldn't imagine this in a refugee camp. And it was being well utilized. And this group had a group of young adults through this organization began a poetry group and a group of, you know, young people who told their stories to each other, which itself was therapeutic, and then also decided they wanted to write it down and share it with other people. And so now they're writing down this stuff and they're sharing it with Arabic audiences, and someday they hope to translate it into English.
We have room for a couple more questions, but I just want to remind everyone that you were given evaluation sheets when you came in. Most everyone got some evaluation sheets. So we'll be collecting them when you leave, but we have room for two more questions. Is that fair?
Sure.
So two more questions. I think the gentleman in the back with the mustache, you had your hand up, and I think Nancy, you had your hand up also, right? One and two. And then also, just to reiterate, if anyone has questions you'd really like to answer, once we dismiss everyone after these two general questions, you may stay here and our speakers will speak to you individually about your questions.
So as far as the Zaatari camp and everything, the educational like outlets for the children are, can you speak to like what they are? They're actually like, do they have formal schools or is there something like that? And the second question is, the camp being so large and everything, who actually like leases the camp to like keep things in control so things don't obviously, you know, get out of control?
Can I add mine into this as well, because it kind of goes along with about the education. I was just wondering, because you said about cell phones being so influential, could they be doing online education?
All right, I'll speak to the last question and then maybe you can speak to the first two. Yes, so there are a lot of youth groups and educational groups inside camps are connecting with global online educational services to try to empower students to take classes. There often, though, is a gap between in language, for one thing, and in the content of the classes. So there's an ongoing, we met with the director of one of the educational, what's it called, working group in Zaatari, who spoke to this issue specifically as one of the most important things that they're working on right now is to trying to connect with an online service provider out of Oman, maybe, and to bridge the gaps in content so that they could access courses online that were actually really interesting to students there. One of the classes that was most interesting was child psychology.
So to go back to my point about employment, the So there are efforts. The camp itself, Za'atari camp, has schools, and some of the children are going to schools. There are some barriers that prevent families from sending their kids to schools, such as perhaps the child needs to work to provide for the family, or it could be that they are worried about, because last week some of the children got into a fight and they just, you know, fled a war, so they don't want any more problems, so they pulled their children from the school. So there are certain cultural barriers, social barriers, economic barriers to go into school. Even though the school in overall is for free, you still have some expenses. So in the city, for example, you still need to figure out how to get to school and to pay some of the supplies, the books, and so forth. So even though it's a tiny amount, the families who are not working obviously cannot afford it. But the problem with education, even though obviously we are in an educational institution right now, is if you provide education, you really have to think about the next step. So if you provide education, we went to one of the centers that's offering computer certificates. So you provide this computer certificate and people graduate, what next? How are they going to find employment with this great certificate that they got? So that's where, again, the long-term thinking has to come in. It's not only about education. It's also about plugging people into jobs once they are done with education. In terms of security, there is all kinds of security on the camp. The way the model is, there are... When the camp initially started, there's what was called street leaders, where the refugees themselves took ownership of the area that they are in. So there are all kinds of efforts from within the community, but the camp itself, there is one main gate that you enter from, and there are security forces around. Yes, yeah. Jordanian.
And some private security to protect various international organizations and NGOs. And in terms of who provides the education in the camp, it's the UN, but it employs Jordanians. It doesn't employ Syrians, much to the chagrin of Syrian educators from Syria who are saying, hey, look, I have a skill, I could use it. Whereas those in cities go to Jordanian public schools, existing Jordanian schools. So on that note, I want to thank you and again reiterate that we're happy to answer any questions if you come up.